Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. If everyone would find their seats, we'll get started in just a few minutes. Thank you.
Please welcome Chief Executive Officer of Sustainable Energy for All and Special Representative of the UN Secretary General for Sustainable Energy, Rachel Kite.
Good afternoon. This is the session you need to be in, okay? Why? Because this is something we can actually fix quite quickly, quite cheaply, and apart from the moral imperative of that, it's actually going to make it much easier for us to fix a whole bunch of other stuff as well. So this session is about the piece of the Paris Climate Agreement that we sometimes forget, which was the leave no one behind bit, right? So let's decarbonize the economy mid-century, let's get to well below 2 degrees, and we will not leave anyone behind. One very clear expression of that is the fact that the energy systems that we've been working with and living with up until this point have miserably failed on that measure. Just under 1 billion people today, with the latest data from 2016, living without any access to electricity. Still almost 3 billion people living in the world today without access to clean fuels for cooking. And of the world's population of 7.5 billion and rising, you know, just about 40% of those people unable to rely upon their energy source. So reliable, affordable, clean energy, something which is tantalizing close for a lot of people and still a very, very long way away for a number of people. It is difficult to imagine how we build those extraordinarily exciting, clean, bright economies that we know that we can, and which so much of the really exciting innovation that we've been showcasing here in California for the last few days, it's difficult to imagine how that's going to work if people don't have access to reliable, affordable, clean power. It's difficult to imagine how we build the kinds of robust, resilient societies that we need if women can't make a different choice than I'm going to clean on this dirty cook stove or this stove which is burning dirty fuels and which is polluting my children, or I'm not going to cook with that. So I either keep my kids healthy or I cook them a meal. That is not a choice that any woman should have to make in 2018. So it's difficult to imagine how we're going to build this bright, bright future without that affordable, clean, reliable power. Now, once the SDGs were agreed, this is SDG 7, for those of you who don't just immediately recall, and after we agreed the Paris Climate Agreement, we kind of had a rough sense of how big the problem was, but we didn't know the detail. Who are these people? Where are they living? What is it that can they afford? How many watts do they need to be able to meet their aspirations in order to be able to do the things that they want to do? And it's been very interesting over the last couple of years to start building the evidence base to really understand what that is, because that's a market as well as an urgent development problem. In a piece of work that SE for All has led together with many other partners called Energizing Finance, we've tried to track the financial flows into this persistent problem, and one that has to be fixed under the politics of the Paris Climate Agreement and has to be fixed in order to achieve the SDGs. And so what we did was we tracked the financial flows, domestic and international, public and private, including philanthropic and other flows, to energy access solutions. What's really interesting is that against an estimate that it's going to take about $45 billion year on year in order to be able to resolve this up until 2030, we were able to track into the 20 countries which represent the biggest and lion's share of the energy access problem. So, you know, I said that there are about a billion people who don't have access to energy today. 80% of that billion live in just 20 countries. I said that just under 3 billion people live without access to clean fuels for cooking. About 84% of that, just under 3 billion, live in just 20 countries. So we can, if we want to, really focus efforts where the access gap is the largest. What we found is that there is about $19 billion of financial flow towards energy access in those 20 countries. But then we started to get down into the detail of that. So, I mean, that's not bad, right? That's like 50% of what is needed is flowing. But then we got down into it, it shows a very different picture. It shows that about three very big populous countries, which international flows are interested in and which have the ability to generate domestic flows, take almost all of that money. And then of the money that's left, that then that starts to flow into the remaining countries. So of the 20, you know, three take up most of it, and then you've got 17 other countries. Those 17 countries are mainly in sub-Saharan Africa. Those countries are post-conflict, war-torn, vulnerable for various reasons. They are the countries that are the most impacted by climate change today and whose vulnerability is increasing by the moment. And that those billion people are often in rural areas and sometimes living in peri-urban and urban areas. And so the trick to closing the energy access gap is grid densification, where the grid exists, and then a large infusion into distributed energy that will reach the people who live below the power lines and some of them that live underneath the power lines. So we found that of that 19 billion that's flowing, most of it's only going to three countries, some of it then goes to the other 17. And then we found that really only a few hundreds of millions are being invested in distributed solutions. And while there are a number of new and exciting initiatives, and I think Lisa Jordan will talk about some of this later and others, and the philanthropy is stepping up, there are many other forms of capital beginning to step up because they see now the contours of this issue and they're committed to trying to close the gap. It is true that today that finance is not yet flowing. So people are raising funds, people are sort of committing funds, but disbursement, deployment, and actual electrons flowing as a result of it hasn't quite arrived yet. There's always a time lag with these things. This is just on electricity. When we looked at clean fuels, we saw that there is an extraordinary gap between the 4.4 billion, which is estimated as the cost of really building a market for clean fuels for 40% of the world's population, and just a few tens of millions, hundreds of millions that are flowing. I say tens of millions because that's what we tracked. We think there's probably a little bit more than that flowing because often solutions for clean cooking are embedded in other development programs and might not be tagged very well. But you know, if you're not tagging it, it means that you're not measuring it, and it shows a complete under-investment and under-importance of the issue. Now, at the same time, work done by the World Bank and others has really plotted how good is the policy environment in many of these countries. And there's been extraordinary work done by the LDC group under the UNFCCC to really understand their own policy environment and really understand what they need to do for themselves, while we hope the rest of the international community and the private sector steps up and does what it needs to do. And we're going to hear from the minister in a moment about the extraordinary leadership under Ethiopia for the LDC group in the recent past. So the policy environment obviously has to improve in these countries in order to attract investment, both domestic and international. The money that's flowing into closing the energy access gap at the moment is very, very white, and it's coming from abroad. And so there's a whole question of how to indigenize the finance and how to help countries that have a large energy access gap invest in their own future. But that needs to be complemented by the promises that were made in the run-up to Paris and in the SDGs. So there's a need for domestic investment. No country has ever, ever built its own infrastructure without vibrant and strong capital markets backing its own infrastructure development, and yet we don't spend enough time on that. At the same time, there is a role, there's a role for multilateral finance, often the go-to place for transmission and distribution, but now has to be the go-to place for the kind of risk capital that's needed and the technical assistance that's needed to build markets. Bilateral development finance made big pledges before Paris, and that money has got to start flowing more quickly. Philanthropy is stepping up to the plate, realizing there's a role for it too. And then there's a very important sector of private finance, working capital, debt finance, private equity. And finance has to turn up at the right place, at the right time, at the right price. Local currency financing, different instruments. There's a lot of experimentation going on. You're going to hear a lot about that in this session and the next session. But to date, it doesn't yet add up. Ladies and gentlemen, if we cannot come together when the technology is available, when the price of that technology has plummeted by more than 70% in just the last few years, when the price of storage is plummeting and the options are beginning to multiply, if we cannot, in a world where business models using cell phones and other technology allow people to be able to make incremental financial decisions with so much more sophistication, if we cannot bring all of this that we know to the problem of people having access of reliable energy, affordable energy, clean energy, then who are we? And what did Leave No One Behind mean in 2015? I'm going to invite the panel up here now to discuss some of the solutions, some of the leadership that's needed, leadership from ministers, leadership from a campaign of faith and philanthropy, leadership from a CEO of an energy company doing extraordinary things. So please join me. Vaishali Sinard is the Chief of Corporate Social Responsibility for Renew Power, doing amazing things, which he's going to tell you about. Lisa Jordan, who's the Executive Director of Shine, which is a campaign for faith and philanthropy to close the energy access gap. She's going to tell us much more about that. And I'm personally really honored to be able to invite Dr. Gamedo, who is the Minister of Environment, Forests and Climate Change for Ethiopia, and he is the outgoing chairperson of the United Nations Framework for Climate Change, LDC group. So he's the guy that does the really hard work of trying to keep this process moving forward. Thank you very much. How are you, Minister? You need your microphone. So, Ethiopia, which I think a lot of people associate with really large infrastructure projects, some of them in the energy sector, has still a very large unelectrified population. You're a very large country, populous country, country that's industrializing very quickly. It'd be really interesting to hear from you how the international community could best support you to achieve the targets that you've set for green growth, but embedded in that is the electrification of the country, which is going to be so important for you to meet your poverty targets as well. And I know that you've got a big announcement to make today as well, but you can talk about all of that all at once. Use that one.
Very good afternoon. Thank you very much. Yes, Ethiopia is one of the most populous countries in Africa, second to Nigeria. We have 101.5 million people in the country, and also one of the country in the most volatile region, struggling with development, struggling with transforming the economy and also ensuring peace and the security in the region, most of them being related to climate change, frequent drought, and also in some cases floods. And we from the very beginning have been focusing on renewables, More than 90% of our current energy is coming from renewables, including the hydropower, geothermal, and the wind. Those are only few initiatives. By the way, one step back, when I was in the primary school, my mother was helping me to read using bamboo firewood, and I have to sit next to the fireplace, what most people do for luxury, but for basic education needs. And that history is not changed in many parts of the rural areas. And the Ethiopian government has put in place a very clear and ambitious target of rural electrification and off-grid options to reach out the local communities in the rural areas where infrastructures are most limited. So in this context, we have very good policy provisions. We have very good commitment from government, but limiting factors, number one, human capacity, infrastructure, financial resources, and although market opportunities out there, we could not do as much as we wanted to do in bringing on board the private sector, because for 101 million people, there is a huge market there, even for the private sector. And in this context then, also on behalf of least developing countries and Ethiopia, we are calling for one, energy access, which is fair, affordable, and sustainable, and also ensuring sustainable collaborations, partnership, and addressing the global targets, including the sustainable development goals and the Paris Agreement provisions, and implementation of that agreement is of high importance for least developing countries, including my country.
Okay, I think I keep forgetting I've got this thing around my head, so I don't need my hand held. So we're going to come back to you in a moment, sir. But Lisa, so you're the executive director of Shine, and I think we've got a number of Shine founders in the room. I think Ellen's in the room, Ellen Dorsey, and Fletcher Christian, I don't know if you're here, and SE for All has also been involved in supporting the beginning of this campaign. So why don't you talk to us about what the origin of the campaign and what you're trying to do and how it's going.
Thanks a lot. We can't actually see you, so if you're in the room, shout out, because we can't see you.
Yeah, Ellen's there. I can see her. Yeah.
So I want to use three words to describe Shine's contribution to the access to energy, to ending energy poverty, and that is mobilization, opportunity, and momentum. And if I start where the partners started of Shine about 18 months ago, when faith groups, financial organizations, philanthropy, and access to energy champions came together, it was because of the moral imperative that Rachel so eloquently spoke to. If we are in the process of going through a transition, we're in the process of a revolution, and Shine partners are completely committed to ensuring that that revolution, that energy revolution, is truly, truly, truly transformative for the very poor who are growing up in the way the Ethiopian minister just articulated, with wood, with kerosene, with paraffin lamps as the fuel source for their daily needs. And if we have a moral imperative to ensure that that community does not get left behind. And it's really important, and one of the reasons it's really important is because the very large dirty fuel companies are using this energy frontier as the excuse to expand their operations. And for those of you who are coming from faith communities, you will have noted that the largest oil companies in the world went to see Pope Francis 2 months ago and said, "We're serving the poor." So we think it's important to look at that social license to operate and say, no, that is not the kind of energy transformation that we want to see. We want to see an energy transformation that puts the last mile first, where access to energy is made available to the very poorest. So if you want to stop the fossil fuel industry, I think ending energy poverty absolutely has to be a part of your strategy.
Thank you. Renew Power is the largest renewable energy independent power producer, I believe, in India. So could you talk a little bit about how you think about the energy access challenge? And I think it would be really good to hear from your perspective how you think you can accelerate the solution to the challenge. Because I mean, in India, at least, you have a prime minister that's put this on the radar, as it was, and made commitments to it politically, whereas in some other countries, that political leadership hasn't yet materialized.
Sure. Thank you, and I'm delighted to be here amongst this August gathering. It's a fantastic event. I think a great platform for like-minded people to come and discuss these issues. At Renew, I've been hearing narratives around how the renewable energy space has emerged over the last 7-8 years as a boutique sector to one which is becoming a force to reckon with, which is pretty much moving at its own steam. In India, Renew Power was founded by Sumant Sinha about 7 years ago. At that time, people didn't really know what an independent power producing company was. Since then, we have a prime minister who's committed that we're going to generate, or at least target generating, 227 gigawatts of clean energy by 2022. Which is a pretty significant target to have, and we're moving ahead in the right direction. Renew Power was the first independent power producer to have crossed the 1 gigawatt milestone in India after 5 years of establishment. And then after that, in a year, we doubled to 2 gigawatts of generation. And as we speak, we generate about 4 gigawatts of clean energy. So ours is an entrepreneurial venture. So for those of you here and for others who are not here, I'd just like to reiterate that you can be profitable by being in a business which is clean, green, and socially responsible. And we are very proud to be doing that. Talking about rural electrification, Renew Power believes that we not only want to contribute towards being a green and a clean company, but we really want to work in our communities. And towards that, I lead the sustainability initiative. We've been working with Grassroot India to set up microgrids. We've set up 25 megawatts of microgrids as a part of a pilot program in the northern state of Uttar Pradesh. And I'm here to commit and present our commitment to powering 100 villages in the next 10 years. And that's a part of our commitment. And thank you. And
the impact. Come on, a bigger round of applause.
Thank you. And as a part of that, what we're going to be able to do is that we're going to reach 330,000 households. We'll impact the lives of over 150,000 individuals. And we'll ensure an energy access to people who are living in these villages. The unique thing about, so this is SDG 7 contribution we are looking to make. But I always like to say that nothing is as powerful without engaging women. So we have, as a part of a program, women ambassadors who are going to be working in this, as a part of this program. And we hope to create an army of women entrepreneurs to take this forward. So I'm really excited about contributing to SDG 5 as well, because I believe without the power of women, there's not much that we can do. So that's a little bit about Renew and what we're planning to do.
Thank you very much. I think we could just steal a little bit more time. Nobody's telling me to get off the stage yet. So. They'll come and wrestle me in a minute. But can you, I mean, I think you've all three got announcements that you're making, but can you, to this audience, I think it's really important that in a conference on global climate action, that people really understand, you know, the centrality of this issue, but also what they need to be doing. So, you know, what does this audience need to do when they walk out of here to make sure that this isn't the sort of afterthought that too often it is?
Excellent. As indicated in my earlier intervention, we need partnership, we need collaboration, and we need business to be aligned with the Sustainable Development Goals and the wish of conserving our ecosystem, natural resources, and the livelihoods of the communities. In this context, the least developed countries, as Ethiopia represents also that group, and also speaking on behalf of my country, we have been trying to lead by example. And to lead by example cannot be only a wish, it has to be demonstrated by practical actions, be it at policy level or planning level. And there are certain initiatives I'm happy to share with you. For example, the least developing countries have put in place five initiatives now functioning in this context. The first one, the Renewable Energy and the Energy Efficiency Initiative for Sustainable Development, which has a vision of having affordable energy to all citizens and people-centered interventions. So in this context, we need governments, private sector, civil society, communities to come on board and support the initiative so that we can achieve what we wanted to achieve in our respective plans and objectives, and also in our respective mandates. The other initiative we have in place is the Adaptation and the Resilience Initiatives, what we call LIFE-AR. And again, this is about sustaining economic development and environmental safety and ensuring sustainable development. The third initiative is Devolved Climate Finance, and the other one, the universities consortium from the least developing countries closely working together and pulling their human capacity expertise to support human capacity development in the region. And again, in this context, we need universities and institutions, research institutions, in a position to support such initiative to come on board and support the objectives and activities of this group. And the last one is long-term, low-carbon, climate-resilient development strategy development. Unless we have a roadmap and a plan to address current challenge and also achieve what we wanted to achieve, we won't reach anywhere. So such very organized, coordinated initiatives needs contribution from each and everybody of you, because when we are together, when we act together, we can bring a solution, a sustainable solution that would improve the livelihoods of our communities and ensure our development. In the Ethiopian context, for example, we have put in place climate resilient green economy, and this has been part of our national planning, and we have been implementing it with our national budget, and also closely working with development partners and institutions from different perspectives, and trying to lead by example. And as I said, nobody can achieve its goal, its objective alone, and we need each other in business, in economic development, and in environmental, in protections, in the natural resource conservation. And let's get united and do for the betterment of our communities, our people, and our planet Earth. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you very much. So Lisa, very briefly.
Very, very quickly. If you are a person of faith, that we are mobilizing with faith communities. So you can do parish to parish, you can do ashram to ashram, you can do mosque to mosque, you can do church to church. Bring
somebody
with you.
And temple to temple.
And temple to temple. Bring somebody with you. So if you're retrofitting your church or your temple or your mosque or your ashram, retrofit somebody else's with you. It's a big mobilization. It's part of the shine. If you're a philanthropy, we have seen that philanthropies have doubled their contributions to ending energy poverty over the last 2 years. They've doubled their contributions. It's still a tiny little drop in the bucket. And there are only, I can count them really literally on two hands, how many foundations have committed programs to this particular issue. We are not going to reach the 1 billion with 20 foundations. That's not going to happen. So there's a huge amount of room. We can all work together and collaborate. We've put together a nice circle so that people can learn from one another about how to get engaged in this issue. And the last thing I'll say is that the financial community is responding. It's a very exciting response. It's a six-fold response from 10 funds. That's six times greater than what has been able to be deployed in capital in the last 3 years. So we've got new funds coming online to the tune of $1.5 billion, and they have already raised half of that. So it's a really big opportunity for you to get engaged and make sure that these funds are successful, because they represent a greater level of maturity in the field than we've seen up to this point. So it's a very exciting momentum. I told you, mobilizing and organizing and momentum, these are the three things. So there's a lot of opportunity here for everyone to get engaged.
Thank you. The last word, Ashley.
Okay. So Renew Power has been a very unique venture where we've mobilized global funds to generate renewable energy, clean energy, in the remotest part of the country, a country with 1.2 billion people, over 300 million people lack access to energy. So it's a great challenge, but with challenges come opportunities. And through our foundation, where we are going to be setting up these microgrids in the remotest parts of the country, I'd like to invite partners, whether it is technology partners, whether it is partners with funds, to come together and to work with us to be able to get the microgrids in place in the remotest parts of the country. So together, let's step it up.
So thank you very much. I think we're going to exit this way, and I'm going to say something that I've wanted to say for a long time, which is now, ladies and gentlemen, Shilpa Patel. Well, I'm not allowed to say that. Shilpa and I used to work together. I won't tell you what I said at one of her retirement parties, but she can tell you. Ask her afterwards. Bye, Shilpa.
Thank you, Rachel, and good afternoon, everybody. Rachel Kite's generally a very hard act to follow, particularly when I'm standing between you and the reception. But
my name is Shilpa Patel,
and I'm Director of Mission Investing at Climate Works Foundation. We are a global philanthropic organization based here in San Francisco with a staff of about 70 people. And essentially, we bring charitable foundations together to be more effective and strategic in a collective response to climate change.
You can go.
We provide deep expertise on a number of climate-related issues, and I'm particularly happy to note that we've... but I'm... Sorry. Oh, I see. Okay. Well, I'm still particularly happy to note that we've helped structure a couple of the exciting initiatives that you're going to hear about in this session. Just want to set the stage a little bit. We are midway between the commitments made in Paris and 2020, by when we really need to have, you know, bent the emissions curve and set ourselves firmly on a path to decarbonization. So now the UNFCCC estimates that $1.5 trillion of finance will need to be mobilized every year between now and 2030 if we are to meet our Paris commitment. And some people, in fact, feel that this is the lower end of an estimate. So investment in low carbon and climate resilient technologies and solutions is a critical part of winning the fight against climate change and ensuring that we are able to respond to the impacts of a changing climate. So the future of our planet is literally riding on this. Now, governments can certainly set the right policy frame and lead the charge, as so many countries, states, yay California, and local jurisdictions are doing and are doing. But the rest of us, the private sector, philanthropy, civil society writ large, must step up to the plate. And we will all need to cooperate and collaborate in new ways, potentially, unprecedented ways. Now, we've heard a lot about large financial institutions and investors making exciting announcements on finance mobilization for climate action. I mean, that's what this summit is about, in a way. But many emerging and highly promising climate solutions are simply not at the scale today where traditional capital markets are willing to invest in them. This leaves potential solutions stranded or abandoned at early stages because of the lack of availability of risk capital. And also, some climate change investment, like clean energy mini-grids, ask investors to take high investment risk but provide essentially infrastructure-type returns. So decarbonization is definitely going to need technological innovation, but it's also going to need creative minds that can innovate new business models and can adapt solutions to new markets. And we can't address today's problems with yesterday's financial toolkit or frame of mind. And I firmly believe that philanthropy has a very important role to play to basically deploy resources in ways that can catalyze and mobilize commercial capital. Essentially, we need to kickstart flows of capital to low carbon investment. And this is where philanthropy, I think, can play a role. So, innovation, creative minds, and that is exactly what the people that I'm going to call up to the stage have done and are doing, and I'm going to call them up one by one, and they will come and tell you about all the exciting and promising initiatives that they're involved in. So first up, Danny Kennedy, come on up. So Danny is managing director at CALCEF, the California Clean Energy Facility.
Helping create this amazing ecosystem of entrepreneurs and companies that are going to fill this 100% electric grid with renewable power as set by law on Monday, which is so exciting. But in the last couple of years, we've also been seeking to create and promote startup companies around the world in markets that matter from a climate point of view, like Indonesia, India, China, and East Africa and West Africa and elsewhere. And once you do that, you succeed in spinning up a bunch of startups. All of a sudden, lo and behold, they need money. They need various forms of equity and debt and working capital and all sorts of things. And so I am here today to announce a couple of things that we've done in the last month or so, really just closing them. One is a really important transaction by our innovations fund, the C3 entity, to take a grant from the Hewlett Foundation and to turn it around with structuring support from ClimateWorks and others as a loan into a bond issuance in India to support the Indian microgrid market. And that's the Seekers transaction, which Pawan will describe to you next in much more detail. But it's a very important example of this sort of piloting and learning how to do it, how to blend the magic of some debt and equity instruments and to move a whole new niche in a very important total addressable market like microgrids in India. So that $3 million announcement is our big news for the day. We're also very pleased to be announcing a new general partnership we have called the Microgrid Catalytic Investment Fund, which has also been approved by the Investment Committee just in the last month to do two pilot deals in East Africa in this case. We hope to execute on those in the next month. And we have a goal of getting $20 million through the Microgrid Catalytic Investment Fund in both East Africa and India as well over the coming year. And a similar model, really, you know, what we think is happening as we scale solar and microgrids and storage solutions around the world is what has happened here in California over the last decade. I cut my teeth in business, in the solar business here. I started the solar leasing business, Sungevity, and helped start the solar loan company, Mosaic. These debt instruments were not acceptable to mainstream capital providers in America to start. We had to go to philanthropists and crazy heroic debt providers to get them rolling, and then they became mainstreamed, and now they're securitizing hundreds of millions of dollars a quarter in those two markets alone. That will happen in microgrids in East Africa and microgrids in India once we prove it out with these pilot investments, these smaller funds where we can take on some of the risk. The magic is in the blending. What we need to succeed and to scale the thousands and tens of thousands of startups that need to deliver the millions of humans the electricity they deserve in energy access and solve for climate change is for you all to work with us on that creative solution, those debt equity instruments, with some risk tolerance and some creativity, and we'll make it work. Thank you very much.
Pavan Mehra, come on up. Pavan is a venture capitalist and entrepreneur who is chief investment officer of Seekers, which aims to provide tailored finance to the small-scale rooftop solar and mini-grid market in India.
Thank you for the introduction, Shilpa, and thank you, Danny, for the setup. So as Shilpa mentioned, I'm Pavan Mehra. I am CIO of Seekers Finance and here to announce the $3 million sustainable energy bond issuance for India. The bonds are a new and innovative financing instrument that allows impact investors to finance sustainable energy assets exclusively, as well as track their performance on an ongoing basis. And at Seekers Finance, we are pioneering something called project finance, but at a micro scale. And the bonds are meant to be invested in these mini projects. So let me color this with a little background. Many of you may be familiar with personal loans and may be aware that personal loans are linked to incomes of individuals and linked to income alone. And there's a large market for that. Now, something like that is also available for large companies where you get loans linked to cash flows of the project, and that's called project finance. And that's typically available for loans or sizes usually over $10 to $15 million. Now, such financing based only on cash flows is not available to small businesses or to small projects, which is especially needed in the sustainable energy space. And financial institutions always ask for collateral, and many entrepreneurs that might be there in this room will bear that out, that capital of that quantum is not available. This is where we come in. We provide cash flow-backed project loans, typically less than $1 million for sustainable energy companies exclusively. So we are pioneering micro project finance, and in the last 10 years, last year we've done 10 investments alone. So we are targeting spaces. These are particularly distributed segments such as rooftop solar, solar pumps, solar cold chains, mini grids, energy storage. And to support this, we floated the sustainable energy bond, the first issuance of which has been subscribed by CalCEF. Danny alluded to that, and we're thrilled to have their support. The heavy lifting and structuring for that was done by the Climate Works Foundation. Big shout out to Shilpa, who supported that transaction, structuring it and getting it together. Two features that make this unique. The first is the issuances are viable at a size of 2 to 5 million, which is unlike large green bond issuances, many of which we heard in fact, there was even in the previous session, that are typically $50 to $100 million and above. And we've made that possible by standardizing processes and creating an ecosystem of partners that supports this. The second unique aspect is that investors are able to track the impact of their capital on an ongoing annual basis. This is in terms of renewable energy generated, greenhouse gases mitigated, jobs created, people impacted, so on and so forth. And the impact, by the way, these measures have been designed with support from the Climate Policy Initiative and its Climate Finance Innovation Lab. So with this issuance, we're on track to reach our $40 million goal. And if any of you want to learn more about this issuance, how it's done, so on and so forth, or even get involved in it, please let me know. Thank you.
Thanks. Sarah Kearney, come join us. Sarah is the founder and executive director of Prime Coalition, and I'm going to let her tell you what that's about.
Thank you. My name is Sarah Kearney, and I'm the founder and executive director of Prime Coalition. We're a public charity based in Cambridge, Massachusetts, that partners with philanthropists to support extraordinary companies that combat climate change, have a high likelihood of achieving commercial success, and would otherwise have a difficult time raising sufficient financial support. Prime has facilitated over $18 million on a deal-by-deal basis into 10 early-stage companies over the past 3 years, each of which could mitigate at least half a gigaton of CO2 equivalent emissions annually when deployed at scale. The climate financing gap that Prime helps fill happens during the earliest stages of company formation, where traditional investors are in a race to go second or third, but where our climate innovators need someone to go first. Our goal is to help retire the risks that are impossible for commercial investors to underwrite so that follow-on investors will crowd in and our companies will someday be able to deploy their solutions at large scale in places that matter all over the world. As we gather in California today, I want to publicly recognize three of the courageous Californian philanthropists that have worked with Prime to support extraordinary Californian innovators. The San Francisco-based Autodesk Foundation made a recoverable grant to Oakland-based Tro, which makes heating, ventilation, and air conditioning applications twice as efficient without the need for greenhouse gas emitting refrigerants. San Francisco-based Nest co-founder Matt Rogers and his family foundation, Insight Labs, made a program-related investment to Los Angeles-based electric airplane company, Wright Electric. Los Angeles-based Will and Jada Smith Family Foundation made a recoverable grant to San Francisco-based QuidNet Energy, which promises vast cost reduction for grid capacity energy storage. My team at Prime is thrilled to have helped facilitate these and many other investments since 2015, but the world needs many more of these unlikely pairings if we are to address our global climate challenge at scale. Today, I'm announcing a new program, the Prime Impact Fund, which offers philanthropists exposure to a portfolio of early stage companies with one grant decision and will deploy $20 to $40 million of charitable capital over the next 3 years. Our ongoing goal at Prime is to build a tribe of thoughtful philanthropic partners. If you are a foundation grant maker, donor advised fund client or sponsor organization, individual or family office mission investor, or corporate donor, and you believe that technology innovation is a critical part of our fight against climate change, come join us.
Emily Kirsch is next. She is founder and CEO of Powerhouse. Come on up.
Hello, I'm Emily Kirsch, founder and CEO of Powerhouse, based in Oakland. We're here in the San Francisco Bay Area at the heart of global clean energy innovation, and we're here in Silicon Valley at the heart of global venture capital. Yet one of the biggest gaps that we see in advancing us to a world powered by clean energy is where those two, clean energy innovation and early stage venture capital, come together before you and I know the names of the entrepreneurs or the startups that they've created. So that is why Powerhouse is thrilled to announce today at the Global Climate Action Summit a new initiative to back dozens of early stage clean energy entrepreneurs over the next 5 years. These are entrepreneurs that are building an energy system that is decarbonized, decentralized, democratized, and digitized. While we can't share all the details for legal reasons, what we can say is that this initiative is backed by some of the most well-known and respected clean energy and venture executives in the country and some of the biggest multinational energy companies in the world. We have already begun to back these startups. They're active in countries that stand to benefit most from clean energy solutions, including startups that are active in the DRC, in Somalia, in Bangladesh, and many more. What this means for clean energy is that when an entrepreneur is ready to raise smart seed capital, she knows where to go. And when entrepreneurs and the venture community and the corporate community are locked arm in arm, building an unstoppable force to transition us to a world where clean energy is the most abundant and affordable source of clean energy in the world in our lifetime, that is when we win. When you and I and everyone from the countries that we represent have a choice in where our energy comes from. That is what Powerhouse is contributing to with this new initiative. At Powerhouse, we work at the intersection of venture capital, software, and clean energy, all of which have been overrepresented by men. But at Powerhouse, we are women-founded, and we are an all-women team. Because when we talk about shifting power, it's not just about going from dirty energy to clean energy. It's about leadership that reflects the diversity of our country and that lives up to the ideals of our nation and our world. With that, thank you, and power on.
Group.
Thank you. So for the last 2 years, our firm has been looking at the problem of climate adaptation, and specifically, are there any investment opportunities in climate adaptation? And in partnership with three organizations, the Nordic Development Fund, the Global Environment Facility, and the Global Innovation Lab for Climate Finance, we've developed an investment strategy called CRAFT, which we believe is the first private sector investment strategy focused entirely on climate resilience and adaptation solutions. And CRAFT focuses on investing in companies with technologies, products, and services to either assess or manage and reduce the kinds of risks and impacts that are being increased by climate change. And we've become especially interested in companies with software, data analytics, modeling, forecasting. The idea is that actionable information can be our first line of defense against the effects of climate change. And the climate financing gap that we're filling is what the UN has called the adaptation gap, the $300 billion per year needed for adaptation in developing countries alone by 2030. But a recent study by Climate Policy Initiative has shown that over the last 2 years, less than $22 billion has gone to adaptation. So just 5% of total climate finance going to adaptation as opposed to mitigation. And under the Paris Agreement, there's supposed to be equal emphasis on both. So clearly, we need to do more to find ways to scale up adaptation finance the way we've been able to do for renewables and efficiency over the last 20 years. And ideally, we'll find ways to do it faster. So today, we're announcing that in addition to the CRAFT investment strategy, we will create a $20 million technical assistance facility to extend the application of these technologies into low-income countries and small island developing states. Because climate resilience obviously needs to be for more than just wealthy OECD countries. It needs to be available in the countries and for the populations that are the most vulnerable. We recently completed a 50-page design study for this technical assistance facility, funded by our friends at Climate Kick. And the next step is to secure additional funders to reach the $20 million goal. So we'd like to invite governments, development banks, foundations, and private investors interested in closing the adaptation gap to work with us as we launch the CRAFT investment strategy and the new technical assistance facility for developing countries. Thank you.
Alicia Kelman, who is legal counsel with Sun Funder, and little Aiden, legal counsel in the making.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alicia Kelman. I work for a solar finance company called SunFunder. SunFunder provides scalable debt capital for solar businesses that operate in emerging markets. These are companies that often really struggle to access the kind of capital they need to grow and scale. And 2 years ago, we held the first close of our $50 million Beyond the Grid Solar Fund. That fund is now almost fully deployed. So I am thrilled to announce today that we are raising our next and largest facility, our $85 million Solar Energy Transformation Fund. This set fund will be deployed across sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia, and it will help over 3 million people get access to solar energy and will mitigate 500,000 tons of CO2 annually. I'm also very excited to announce that OPIC, the Overseas Private Investment Corporation, has given us initial approval. Final approval will hopefully come tomorrow. For the first anchor investment of the SET fund of $25 million. And the reason I mention it here is actually because I think the really commendable part of what OPIC is doing is their potential commitment is a hybrid of both senior and junior capital. And as these folks probably know, raising junior capital or subordinate capital in general is always the hardest, but it's also the most catalytic and impactful because it brings other investors to the table. So on that note, if any of you would like to help scale solar energy across the globe, please reach out. Thank you.
And last, but by no means least, Scott Jacobs, CEO and co-founder of Generate Capital.
Hi, everyone. It may surprise you to know that climate infrastructure is not just wind and solar farms. Over the last 4 years, Generate Capital has been entirely focused on proving that sustainability pays, that infrastructure is how you actually make inventions matter to the world and impact our climate. We've deployed hundreds of millions of dollars, yes, hundreds of millions of dollars in innovative climate solutions like community solar, like battery storage, like food waste digesters, like distributed wastewater treatment facilities, like electric buses and hydrogen forklifts. Many of these solutions today are considered mainstream. Just 4 years ago when we started the company, they would scare a lot of banks and institutional investors. So yes, we've come a long way, but we have a long way to go. And so today we are happy to announce that we will do another $1 billion of innovative, sustainable climate infrastructure. Yes, that's a billion with a B. We consider ourselves a catalyst to prove these things and to scale this set of solutions that we need. And we are proving that sustainability pays, because there's no way to mobilize more money than to show that the money that you've already mobilized made a lot of money. Yeah. Whether it's the power sector or the transportation sector or the waste and water sector, there are a lot of innovative solutions that are coming thanks to many of the folks who I am lucky enough to share the stage with today and many of the folks that came before them. And those entrepreneurs need help. They need help lots of different ways. They need lots of different types of capital. Sometimes they need project financing. Sometimes they need growth capital. Sometimes they need tax equity. Sometimes they need junior debt. We at Generate are the only one-stop shop for those entrepreneurs. We have a time horizon that is not measured in quarters, and it's not measured in even a 10-year fund life. Our time horizon is forever, and that's the time horizon that matters when we're talking about this planet. So we are thrilled to be here today, and we look forward to talking with all of you and helping prove how much sustainability pays.
Thank you all so very much. This is so inspiring, and it's so wonderful to see seeds being planted and change happening and innovation taking place and showing that this is not something that, you know, a tree-hugging wonk does. This is pretty much entering the mainstream. And with that, please can you give my wonderful, wonderful panel a big round of applause for all their hard work. Rachel, and I hand it back to Rachel for the group hug.
So while you're taking the photographs of the people who are
making this happen, I think I just want to emphasize three things. First of all, this is a problem to which there are solutions. Those solutions, and you've seen, there are so many green shoots now in the innovation of the financial models and the business models that can solve the problem, that there is absolutely no reason for anyone to leave this room and not be able to find a way for them to be part of this incredible story. The idea that we are going to be able to... For the millennial. Well, I think that's a centennial, actually, not a high centennial. No, but just to be really focused, when you leave this room, there is something for you to do. You know, there is something, you are either in a position whereby you can put this further up the agenda in your financial institution. You are either in a position where you can take more risk because the size of the market, the size of the opportunity, and what it will do for economies and what it will do for families and what it will do for communities is exponentially better than what we have at the moment. There is no discussion about whether closing the energy access gap is not a piece of climate action. The idea that we're going to close the energy access gap by buying cheap out-of-the-box coal-fired power technology or providing some kind of diesel solution, and that's going to be A, viable, B, economically sensible, C, viable from a health perspective, this is rubbish. And this notion is dead and is going to be knocked on the head from an economic, a financial, and from a societal perspective very soon. So there's no debate about cleaning, whether we have to move climate action first or whether we have to sort of stop and then reverse and make sure that everybody has access to energy. This is ridiculous. This is where the excitement comes. And let me tell you that when you walk into a community or when you walk into a household and they have access to clean, reliable, affordable energy, the transformative impact on their lives, their job opportunities, the business opportunities, what it does to the community, what it does to the status of women, what it does to their children is extraordinary. And if we can do that, and these people are showing you how, household by household, village by village, community by community, country by country, then we will, for the first time ever in our history, have a resilient, reliable, affordable, clean set of energy systems. And as somebody already said, in a world where the energy system never met our needs up to now, to a world where it will not only meet our needs but lift us up, we will be digitalizing that system, we will be decarbonizing that system, we'll be decentralizing that system, and in that process, ladies and gentlemen, we will be democratizing the energy system and the economy as well. Thank you very much. Well done, you.